Hello viewers, welcome to my channel. I'm Hasham Ali Khan. So last video I have explained you about the meaning of the term tax, characteristics, features of tax, objectives of tax, then types of tax, classification of direct and indirect tax. Hope you have watched that video. Now in this video I am going to continue the introduction part. In this video I am going to discuss two topics, that is canon of taxation and the basic concepts which are frequently used in income tax. So first of all, I'm going to explain you about canons of taxation. This is also one of the theory question which may be asked in examination. What are the canons of taxation? What do you mean by canons of taxation? The canons of taxation are the directive principles which should be followed by the government while framing the taxation policy and imposing tax on the people. So while framing the tax policy and imposing the tax on the people, the government must follow some directive principles. See, tax is not an arbitrary thing. The tax has to be implemented after careful study. What will be the consequences of imposing this tax? The government, what principles the government has to follow are called directive. Nowadays, the objectives of the government have increased. The activities of the government have increased, social activities, economic activities, political activities, so many activities are there. So in order to perform all the activities, the importance of tax have increased. But arbitrarily, without thinking, tax cannot be, the tax policy cannot be framed. Directly, arbitrarily, taxes cannot be imposed. So what are the principles the government will follow in order to frame the taxation policy? Are called canons of taxation. Adam Smith has given a number of canons of taxation. Few of the canons of taxation I'm going to explain you. First one, canon of equality. The taxes should not be equal, but it should be based on the ability to pay. The first thing the government has to remember is when tax is imposed, a high rate of tax should be imposed on rich people and low tax rate will be applied on the poor people according to the ability of payment of tax. When a person is having more ability, more tax should be applied. When a person is having less ability, less tax should be applied. This is called canon of equality. That is the first canon given by Adam Smith. Second, canon of certainty. That means the taxes should be such that the payer should be certain about the amount to be paid, about the date to be paid, about the form to be paid. All these things should be completely certain. There should not be any inconvenience on the part of the taxpayer. It should be popular. It should be clear. Canon of economy. Canon of economy says the expenditure incurred on collecting the tax should be minimum. Otherwise, what is the purpose of imposing the tax? For example, government is spending 100 rupees to collect the tax and collecting the revenue only 50 rupees. Then what is the purpose of collecting 50 rupees? The cost of collection should be minimum. The taxes should be economical. Next one, canon of convenience. Convenience means the tax should be applied at that time where the assessee is having the money. Unnecessarily burden or wrong timing should not be used. Example, a person who is getting the salary, so at the time of salary itself some tax will be deducted, TDS will be made. At the time of imposing the tax on people who are selling the goods, at the time of sale only he has to pay the tax. The taxes should be convenient. It should not make any inconvenience on the part of the payer. Next, canon of productivity. That means canon should be such that the productivity should not come down. The productivity should increase. The government requires more and more revenue for different activities, for developmental activities. The taxes should not discourage the people from paying the tax. The taxes should be productive. Then next one is simplicity. One of the problem of Income Tax Act is we have so many provisions. It will be highly difficult for the people to understand the provisions of income tax. So provisions of income tax should be made as simple as possible so that the people can be able to understand and follow the taxation rules. Then elasticity. The canon of elasticity says that taxes should not be rigid. the taxes should not be fixed. It should be elastic. Example, when the government is in need of huge funds, more funds, because some natural calamity occurred, the government requires more funds, the government should increase the rate of tax. Similarly, during normal times, the government does not have any abnormal expenditure, the government should reduce the tax. The government should give more exemptions, more deductions to the tax pay. So in this way, it should be elastic. Last one, canon of diversity. Diversity means we should not have more number of taxes. It will become complications. So only few taxes. That is the reason why when GST has been implemented, removing all other different types of indirect taxes. Different types of indirect taxes have been removed. A single tax GST has been implemented. So diversity means don't put a number of taxes. Few taxes should be implemented. So these are some of the canons of taxation given by Adam Smith. Now I'm going to explain you about basic concepts of income tax. While studying income tax subject, a number of concepts will come across. A student must know the technical meaning of those concepts. And in examination, these will be asked in short question. In short question, what do you mean by SSC? Who is an SSC? What do you mean by previous year? What do you mean by assessment year? What is permanent account number? What is income? Who are persons? These are the different terms, concepts which are used. First one, SSC. Very frequently it will be asked in examination. SSC is the person from whom any tax or any other sum of money like interest or penalty is due to the income tax department. Again, I repeat, SSC is a person from whom any tax or any other sum of money like interest or penalty is due to the income tax department on his own income or on the income of any other person for which he is liable. He is liable to pay. He is assessable to pay. Or a person to whom the refund is due from the income tax department. Again, you listen, you watch this video, you will come to know the meaning of the term SSC. The person from whom any tax or any other sum of money like interest or penalty is due to the income tax department for his own income or on the income of any other person for which he is liable to pay, or a person to whom refund is due, or a person against whom the proceedings has been started. Income tax proceedings has been started. Now one by one. Normally a person is liable to pay tax if his income is more than the basic exemption limit. Suppose for the current assessment year, the basic exemption limit is 2,50,000. So if a person's income is below 2,50,000, no need to pay the tax. He is not an SSC. If his income exceeds 2,50,000, then he is an SSC. He is liable to pay tax. Similarly, a person against whom income tax proceedings has been started. Example, a person whose income is more than basic exemption limit, but he has not paid the tax. So income tax proceedings will be started. The person will become SSC. Similarly, a person who does not have the income, but if another person is there for which he is liable. For example, a person does not have his own income, but he is a guardian, or he is the parent of a minor or a lunatic person. So the head of the person is liable to pay tax not on his income, but on the other minor income or on the other lunatic income, like that. So similarly, a person to whom the income tax is refundable. That means a person has paid more tax to the income tax department. Nothing is due, but income tax department has to return him some tax amount. That is called refund. So a person to whom refund is due from income tax department is also called an SSC. Now person. Normally we mean person means a natural person. We are all natural person. But Income Tax Act says person means an individual person. A Hindu undivided family, HUF, a joint stock company, a partnership firm, an association of persons, and every artificial juridical person. All these are persons. The government will collect the tax not only from individual. The government will collect the tax from HUF. HUF is a Hindu undivided family. It's a family business running from ancestors. The head of the family is called Karta, and Karta has to pay the tax on the income of the HUF. Similarly, a joint stock company is an artificial person, and this company has to pay the tax because that is also a person. Partnership firm, a two or more than two persons are running a joint business. That's a partnership. Partnership is also a person. An association of persons, it is not a partnership, but association of persons like joint venture. They have to pay the tax. Every artificial juridical person like municipal authorities or different types of association of persons. All these are persons. Previous year. Previous year means a period of 12 months immediately preceding the assessment year. Previous year means a period of 12 months immediately preceding the assessment year. For example, the current assessment year is 2021. 2020-2021. This is the assessment year. So immediately before this 1920, 2019-2020. This 2019-20 is the previous year. 2019-2020. This is the previous year. And the current assessment year is 2020-2021. So previous year means the 12 months period immediately preceding the assessment year. The income earned during previous year is taxable in the assessment year. That's why previous year is called income year. Previous year is called income year. The income you have earned in the previous year is liable to pay tax in the assessment year. The next one is assessment year. Assessment year means a period of 12 months beginning from 1st April and ending on 31st March next. 31st March next. The current assessment year is 2021. That means it was started on 1st April 2020. It was started on 1st April 2020 and ending on 31st March 2021. 31st March 2021. This is called assessment year. So income earned in the previous year is taxable in the assessment year. That's why previous year is called income year. And assessment year is called tax year. Then income. Actually, income tax is a tax on income. But Income Tax Act has not specifically given what is income. What is income? The Income Tax Act has not specified. Only some judgment, some court judgments are there to identify whether it is income or not. So only a few inclusive definitions are given. Income Tax Act has given inclusive definition. Income includes the following: profits and gains of business or salary received by the employees, like that examples are given. So in other words, we can say every income is a receipt. Every income is a receipt of a person, but every receipt is not an income. The SSC has to prove that it is a receipt, but it is not an income. Example, a person has taken a loan of 10,000. Suppose I have taken a loan of 10,000. So this loan of 10,000 is a receipt, but it is not an income. It's a liability. Afterwards, I have to repay it. So there is no tax on this receipt. Whereas if I earn salary, that is a receipt as well as income. So every income is a receipt, but every receipt is not an income. SSC has to prove that this is a receipt, but not an income. So he will not be put to tax. Court has given different judgments on incomes. So by seeing those judgments, we can say whether it is income or not. Example, first one, income received in cash or kind, both are taxable. If income is received in kind, it will be converted into cash by applying the income tax provisions. Income should be earned from outside. That means a person cannot earn income from himself. Example, a person has given some pocket money to his son. So the pocket money received by the son is not an income because it is not generated from outside. Similarly, Income Tax Act says we are not concerned about legality of the income. That means even illegal income is also taxable. So in this way, some judgments are given by Supreme Court and High Court regarding the treatment of incomes. Next come gross total income. Income Tax Act has given five heads of income. Income from salary, income from house property, profits and gains of business and profession, capital gain, other income. These are the five heads of income. The total of five heads of income is called gross total income. Very easy. The total of five heads of income. Income from salary, income from house property, profits and gains of business and profession, capital gain, other sources. Gross total income. Total income. From gross total income, deduct the deductions available from section 80C to 80U. The Income Tax Act has given so many deductions to persons who are qualifying to get the deduction. 80C deduction, qualified saving. 80G deduction, donation. 80D deduction. Like that, so many deductions are there, 80C to 80U. If a person is eligible to get the deduction, the amount will be deducted. From GTI, all deductions are deducted from 80C to 80U. The resulting figure is called total income. From total income, basic exemption limit is deducted. The basic exemption limit, for example, 2,50,000 for a non-senior person. Non-senior person, 2,50,000. Deduct 2,50,000, it is called taxable income. Now, return of income. A prescribed format is given by the Income Tax Department. A prescribed format is given by the Income Tax Department for the purpose of submitting the details regarding the incomes, savings, investments, deductions of the SSC. So SSC has to give all the details of his income, saving, deductions, etc. in the form of a prescribed form. That prescribed form is called return of income. That means a person has to give all the details of his income, etc. in the form of a specified format, specific format given by Income Tax Department. That is called filing the return. Next one is permanent account number. Every SSC will be allotted an account number by the income tax officer. So whenever a person's income is more than the basic exemption limit, he has to apply to the Income Tax Department for getting the permanent account number. It's a unique number which is given to every SSC, a different number for easy identification. The income tax will not recognize the person by his name, because there is a possibility that so many people have same name. So it will be difficult for Income Tax Department. There will be confusion. So Income Tax Department has given a unique number to every SSC. So an SSC has to apply to the Income Tax Department and get the permanent account number, PAN number. And this PAN number is very, very important. So whenever a person, when SSC communicate with the Income Tax Department, he has to quote the PAN number. So Income Tax Department will identify the person with the help of PAN. So the only once a person has to get the PAN, only once, not every year. So a person cannot have more than two PANs. If a person is having more than two PANs, he will be punished. He will be punished by law. It's a crime. Every person must have only one permanent account number. So in this video, I have explained you about canons of taxation and the basic concepts which are used in Income Tax Act. Inshallah, I will continue the next topic in the next video.